Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our session today. We are very excited to have you for our sixth version of the business recovery series. We are very excited. Today we are honored to host Mr. Daniel Birungi, who is the Executive Director of Uganda Manufacturers Association, and he's going to share with us on this subject of the opportunities in the manufacturing sector. I will request all of us to just quickly share, as our usual tradition is, just introduce yourself in the chat room. You can tell us your name and the business which you do. We'll give our colleagues another 5 minutes to log on, and then we should be able to start our session. Very happy to have you here today again, and let's just keep pushing. Let's keep telling our friends to join so that we can be able to start on time. Let's give ourselves 5 minutes to start. Please do share with us your name, the business which you do. You could make a business network today, so please do that as we prepare for our session today. Victor, I hope you can hear us now. You're most welcome. We are just about to start. We're giving ourselves 5 minutes to start. Victor, please respond if you can hear us. I hope our connections are good. I just want to say thank you. I want to welcome everyone who has joined us this morning. Baguma, most welcome. Benjamin Bichungu, most welcome. Brian Azmam Chap, most welcome. Bruce Kakimpa. Bruce, I'm happy to see you here. Thank you for joining us. David Katende. David, most welcome. We're very excited to have you. Emily Gakiza. Emily is one of our Emily, we're very happy to see you. Thank you so much. Emily is in the legal profession, and if you need any legal services, Emily can be very helpful. Yes, Eric Senyange, we're very happy to see you. Thank you so much for being here. Godfrey Kiberu, most welcome. We're very happy to see you. Mark Jimmy, thank you for being here. Maureen Dahura, very happy to have you here. Thank you so much for coming and joining us. Maureen, yes, Maureen, we are very happy to have you. We are honored to have you here. Mr. Moses Okello, glad to have you. Thank you for joining us today. Joseph Omo, thank you so much for being here. Martha Navisere, Martha, thank you for joining us. Ruth, yes, Royola, Ruth, we're very happy to have you. Thank you so much for joining us. Samuel Ochan, very excited to have you. Thank you so much for coming and joining this session. Sylvia Nambozo, thank you so much for being here. Mr. Titus Tusime, Titus, thank you for joining us. James Kalunji, Thank you so much for being here. We are very excited to have you. And Victor Kansime, thank you for joining us. Once again, I encourage all of us to introduce ourselves in the chat room. Please do tell us your name. Do tell us your areas of interest, the business which you do. We hope that you can make a network during this session, which can be helpful. Daniel is already with us and is going to take us through. We're very honored to have him here. He oversees the organization that kind of brings together all Ugandan manufacturers, the big, the medium, the small, and he has a wealth of knowledge on how we can enter this sector. So it is a very exciting session that we are going to have today. We should be starting within the next couple of minutes. Mr. Paul Ekudu, thank you so much for joining us. We are excited to have you here. Great. Titus says he's interested in manufacturing, especially value addition in agriculture. That's very exciting. Actually, as you put those comments, they'll also give some guidance to Daniel as he shares with us today. Please do go to the chat room and share any comments. Solome Nanteza, we are very happy to have you here. Thank you for joining us. We are very excited to have you. Edith Namuenge, we are very excited to have you. Gary Salimo, thank you so much for joining us. We are very happy that you're here. Once again, please do post in the chat room. Tell us your name and the business which you do. We certainly hope that this can help us to first of all better understand who is in the room. We hope that some business deals can go down after 1 hour, 1.5 hours here. We hope that some business can be done. We are very excited that you're here, but we're here to network. My name is Ronald Mokasa. I'll be the moderator for this session today. I work with Enterprise Uganda. I'm the director in charge of research and learning at Enterprise Uganda. Enterprise Uganda as an institution is an institution which is here to support small and medium-sized enterprises to be able to grow largely with business development services, ranging from training, advisory services, networking and linkages, and support with the entire journey from starting all the way from to growing your business. And we are very excited that you're joining our network today. There are a number of faces, a number of people who have been part of these sessions. Please tell a friend about the recovery series. Every Thursday at 9 o'clock, we kind of invite someone who can be able to share on the subject which we believe can help you on your entrepreneurial journey. David tells us he's a master trainer for MSMEs with the ILO Start and Improve Your Business, Gender and Entrepreneurship, together ahead of the Bank of Uganda Financial Literacy Team. Danny, thank you so much for being here, David, and sharing what you do. We have Godfrey Chiveru, who is from Chris Grow, Uganda, who are into export of fresh and fresh fruits and vegetables, and last year ventured into avocado processing, healthy teas, avocado oil, and other cosmetics. Thank you so much, Godfrey, for being part of this. Brian is an entrepreneurship and business turnaround consultant, is here and is currently supporting Nexus International University as a business and funding advisor. Thank you so much, Brian. We are excited to see you. Brian has shared his contact. Solomon Nanteza is works with Prudential Assurance Uganda. Yes, she has shared her contact. In case you need her services, please don't hesitate. Don't hesitate to join. I see John says you can't hear. Let me just check. Victor, please do turn on your audio. And John, that's why you can't hear. Just turn your audio on, and I think also Sisi hasn't turned their audio on. That's why you won't hear what we are saying. George, you can help me just post a message on the same so that we can be able to advise those colleagues. So we should be starting just about now. Baguma says in the hospitality consultant. Thank you so much, Baguma, for being here. Edith, thank you for introducing yourself and telling us. You did tell us what you do. Great. So Daniel is going to lead us in the session today. Daniel is the executive director of the Uganda Manufacturers Association. The Uganda Manufacturers Association is the umbrella body which brings together Ugandan manufacturers. Some of you have known the Uganda Manufacturers Association all the way from your school days with that popular, exciting trade fair which they put together. But as Daniel will tell us, it's an organization which does much more. Today is here to open our eyes of the opportunities in the manufacturing sector. And it is for that reason that we have invited him, and we are very excited about what Daniel is going to share. Daniel, please, I hand over to you, and you kind of take us through what you have prepared for us today.
Thank you very much, Ronald, and good morning to you all on this cold Thursday morning. I'm indeed honored to be invited by Enterprise Uganda to speak to you about manufacturing in Uganda, about the opportunities therein, and about why it's important that we all think about manufacturing as an area of focus. I wish to first off also acknowledge quite a number. I see a number of faces that I'm familiar with. Emily from the legal fraternity, we've done a bit of work together. Salimo, Gary, and a couple of others. Good to see that you're on the call. But to all of you as well, thanks for making time this morning. Mine is not really crystal ball gazing. So for those of you who are here to be pointed to a particular area to invest, this is not that kind of a presentation. This is a presentation that really sets the stage for anyone sitting on the fence about whether manufacturing is the right place to be. That's what I'm going to be focusing on. Why should you really consider manufacturing as a key area of investment? I will share my screen because I prepared a slideshow, and then we'll take it from there. You will advise whether you can see my screen. I hope you can.
Yes, Daniel, we can see your screen.
Perfect, perfect, perfect. So, manufacturing in Uganda, really, it doesn't, I can't start the presentation without speaking to why U.M.A. Why U.M.A. is the one making this presentation. And it will be rather brief because U.M.A. essentially is the body that brings together manufacturing and manufacturing support entities in this country. We have been in existence since 1965, although we did break off a little bit during the 70s for obvious reasons. We came back together in 1988, and since 1988, we've had our home at the U.M.A. Show Grounds in Lukogo. Our role is manufacturing sector advocacy. We support manufacturers, one, in advocating for the right policies, number two, in providing support to them as they seek to establish or grow their businesses, and number three, we have a recruitment function. We want to recruit more manufacturers into the economy because we believe firmly that manufacturing is a key game changer for our nation, and it's something that all of us can do, however small we start. Now, looking at that photo, some of you will identify it. That is an aerial view of the Uganda Business Park in Namanve, Industrial Business Park in Namanve, home to quite a number of factories and manufacturing entities. Why I show the picture is I would like you to take a snapshot of that in your mind, because there's a picture I'll show at the end that will illustrate a couple of challenges that we are having as far as manufacturing goes, and that anyone who is wishing to get into manufacturing has to be mindful about. This is a quote from the United Nations, and there's research that indicates, of course, that in spite of the correlations not being perfect, the poorest countries are invariably the least industrialized ones, and the most successful developing countries are at the upper end of the scale. Essentially, this is to show you that manufacturing has been correlated with the increased development for the reasons I'm going to highlight. Manufacturing, as far as job creation is concerned, is critical. And when you are in a country where the majority of the population is below 35% and where there's a very high jobless rate, you need to be thinking about how can we contribute to the creation of jobs. This is a list of industry categories and the jobs that come out of them. And as you will see, manufacturing is heads and shoulders above everything else. Because for every one job created in manufacturing, there are about 744 indirect jobs that come out of that. Sorry, there are seven jobs that are affiliated to each one manufacturing job. Each one manufacturing job leads to seven additional jobs, induced jobs and indirect jobs. What does that mean? That means that for every single hire a manufacturing firm makes, there are seven other people who are going to benefit in terms of logistics, in terms of support services, in terms of extra services to the manufacturing sector. And that is only for durable manufacturing, which speaks to items like cement, steel. But for non-durable manufacturing, it goes down to five, but the number of non-durable manufacturers are a lot more. Hence the need for us to focus on manufacturing as a key game changer. Uganda, as a country, has highlighted manufacturing as its key focus area under its NDP3, National Development Plan 3. And under this, one of the key focus areas is on import substitution. That for the items that we've been importing, can we work on reproducing those items here? And there are a raft of incentives available for anyone looking to step into manufacturing to take advantage of in preparing themselves and in taking and in going into the market. Because once that happens, we are going to be able to be self-sustaining as a nation. And I don't need to explain why this is important, especially for all of us who have been around during the COVID pandemic period and had a challenge at the beginning of accessing even the most basic commodities. As I speak today, we are still reliant on the developing nations for access to vaccines. And yet, this could have been something we could have done here. So that really shows you why the focus on import substitution is critical and why government has gone out of its way to provide support to entities that go into this. Investment regimes, there's quite a bit of incentives. And I know Ronald will share with all of you because he has access to these, as all of you do, on the Uganda Investment Authority portal. There's a significant raft of incentives. I will be delving into some of them. One of which, of course, is that for anyone going into manufacturing, your machinery comes in duty-free. That's a key benefit. And your raw materials, depending on whether they are available local or not, also come in duty-free. Actually, if you go ahead and manufacture for export, you end up not even paying taxes, because at the end of the day, you have the duty drawback feature that enables you to draw back any duties you've paid on any of your inputs as you export your product. Uganda, as a region, I believe is perfectly located. Yes, we have a challenge of access to the sea, but we like to think of ourselves at UM.A as land-linked rather than landlocked. Land-linked because where we are is a nice staging point for access to economies such as the DRC, the Democratic Republic of Congo, such as South Sudan, such as Burundi. Yes, we have a few challenges with access to Rwanda, which is a key pain, but the market provided by all these other nations is a market that we can take advantage of. That's not to mention the fact that indeed, given where we are also a member of the common market for Eastern and Southern Africa, meaning that we get to export a lot of our products, a lot of our manufactured products to COMESA countries at no duty. We have a low cost of labor compared to our neighbors. We have a very young, very agile, very vibrant population that is willing to learn, but is also willing to put in the effort. And this is also a key opportunity for anyone investing in manufacturing, because you won't have long to retrain people to get them to appreciate what you're doing. It doesn't take that long. Challenges. Certainly, there are a couple of challenges, and we've listed them a million and one times before. Issues to do with market access, structural bottlenecks that mean that we cannot access some of our more lucrative locations, credit and the cost thereof. And this is a key area that we are advocating on as the UMA to address cost of power, which is still relatively high, because while in Uganda, you're doing an average of eight to 12 US cents per kilowatt hour, someone in Addis is doing 2.6 US cents per kilowatt hour as far as power is concerned, which of course means that if you're ending up in the same market, you're already operating at a negative and a deficit. The other bit which Enterprise Uganda is solving, and a number of other players, is of course the issue of preparedness for scaling, with the argument being that the average Ugandan entrepreneur, once they reach point X, instead of breaking through the barrier and continuing upwards, is going to choose to invest in a new venture, a separate new venture. So you find Daniel has seven different investments rather than one major investment. The challenge of that is that because you're not scaling, we're not benefiting from economies of scale that we could have benefited from. Human capital development still remains a challenge. We know the challenges we're having in our education sector. The fact that even as we speak today, students are at home and unable to study because of COVID-19 and our preparedness related to that. But today is not a day to dwell on these. It's to focus on the positives. And among the opportunities that we see as key game changers here is that as we enter the African Continental Free Trade Area, we have a very unique opportunity, especially since Africa has been researched to only contribute 2% of global trade, which is really, really minimal, especially when you correlate this with the volumes that come out of Africa in terms of raw product that goes to be processed elsewhere. Later, I'll share a slide that indicates the coffee value chain and the different additives, additional income at each level of the value chain. And you'll understand why, in spite of the fact that we're expecting quite a bit of product, we are only contributing 2% of global trade. The other bit is that only 17% of our exports within the continent are intracontinental, while 59% of what we consume on the continent comes from Asia and quite a bit from Europe. We have a market of 1.3 billion that is on the verge of opening up businesses, and it's on the verge of accessing us. We only need to understand where to go. And this is where entities such as Enterprise Uganda then come in to assist us to research on some of these markets and how we can access them. We need to definitely think of Uganda and the need to reinvent Uganda as the home of manufactured goods for Africa, because given that only 2%, only 17% of the products sold in Africa are from African countries, there's a unique opportunity that, given our proximity, we have an entry into some of these markets. I'm always saying that the biggest challenge or the biggest missed opportunity for Uganda is that we have not, in as much as we've exported peace, not gone ahead to export our Ugandan products to some of the markets that we've exported peace to. These include the DRC, these include South Sudan, this includes Somalia, and part of the challenges are infrastructure. Although these infrastructure challenges are being resolved, as you've heard regarding the opening up of new roads into some of these markets. But just to give you a snapshot of what it means, today the DRC imports milk from Belgium, imports maize and maize meal from Brazil and Argentina, imports chicken and meat from France and Belgium and Netherlands, among others. And it's not for lack of such products in Uganda. It is for lack of effort to take these products there. So the market exists quite a bit. It's up to us to then take advantage of it and figure out how we get into some of these markets. As we move forward in development, as the world moves forward in development, we're also seeing that there's a transfer of low-intensity light manufacturing from Asian countries to Africa. You've all seen the development of the Hawassa Industrial Park in Addis Ababa. And this is really an answer to the fact that today, while previously entities like Marks and Spencer and others were able to manufacture their products in Singapore, in Malaysia, in Sri Lanka, among others, today the cost of production there has gone way too high. Because of that, they are looking for new places to go to. And of course, Africa becomes the easiest next destination. You'll find it surprising that if you look at the leather market, we export quite a bit of raw leather as a country and import quite a bit of finished products in terms of shoes and belts and bags and all sorts of things. And this is really the gap that we need to exploit as entrepreneurs, as to be entrepreneurs looking to get into manufacturing. How do we address the drain of resources from Africa that then come back expensively for us to buy within our shops? Of course, as we do that, there's also the opportunity to support businesses or help businesses do their work sustainably and access some of these markets based on their organic credentials. You've seen all these different certifications, fair trade, organically grown, there's a spec for rainforest grown initiatives. But the advantage here is that when I'm talking to my partners from beyond Africa and they ask about organic produce, essentially 3/4 of what we produce in Uganda is organic because we don't bother to actually do to add chemicals, to add fertilizers or that kind of thing. So we're really at an advantage, but we have not certified our processes. The question is, can we then move into certification? I'll tell you a story of a Ugandan entrepreneur who is currently exporting vanilla to Denmark and making quite a killing out of it because she's gone ahead to seek the certifications for her process. She knows the farmers, she knows the farms, she can document the story of each of the farmers she's getting this vanilla from. As a result of that, her product fetches about 5 times more than regular vanilla within the Danish economy. And this is the case for quite a number of other initiatives. And we need to open our eyes to the opportunity they are in. Another key area is honey. And the fact that today, as a country, we actually have a deficit of honey in the country for consumption. Yet internationally, this is quite a significant market. Is it about $3 billion worth of market for honey internationally? Always there are requests for honey from Uganda, especially given that it's organic in nature, but we're unable to fulfill it. How do we tap into those opportunities? And that is why I'm saying the focus on sustainability, the focus on documenting our value systems and our ecosystems can be key to anyone going into manufacturing and entering some of these markets. Agroprocessing, I did hear the introduction and someone indicated that they are involved in agroprocessing. And I say kudos to you because the biggest opportunity here as a country, especially given that over 70% of our economy is dominated by agriculture, is in value addition to to agriculture, to agriculture produce. We shouldn't today be talking about exporting maize grain anywhere out of this country, because we don't have a shortage of maize mills. But the other bigger issue there is that as we export maize grain, we're also exporting another raw material, which is maize bran. Maize bran, which is key in our industrial sector on feeds, animal feeds, and this is also another potential export. So ours is to say, can we bring the value back home? Which is a good segue into this slide, which explains the coffee value chain. I apologize for the size. It's a portrait mode graphic that could not lend itself quite well to this landscape mode presentation. But I'll take you through it. At growing level, that's at the farm level, the farmer gets 0.07 cents. Okay? And this is based on a yield of 15 cups of brewed coffee per pound of roasted coffee beans. So this is a pound of roasted coffee beans. Then at exporting stage, the exporter gets nearly double that, which is 0.16 of a dollar, which is 16 cents. Okay? At roasting stage, having roasted, the roaster then gets 35 cents. At distribution, they add 0.04 cents for distribution costs to that cost of 0.35. Now, when it gets to retail, which is the cup of coffee you buy in your Starbucks and that kind of Western cafe, it retails at 2.17, which is $2.17. So out of the entire value chain, remember the farmer has lost $2.10. They haven't earned 7 cents. They've lost $2.07. And the question is, how do we then come in to assist these farmers to move up the value chain and be able to do more? So at the very least, they are going up to roasting, then sending off the produce. So the opportunity is there to assist farmers in this regard. I've had a number of agribusiness entrepreneurs and entrepreneur support people on this call. That is an area we need to assist the farmers in. We need to access that kind of machinery, that kind of training to help our farmers. But this is not only, this is illustrative, but is pretty much the case when you go to the cotton value chain, when you go to the maize value chain, when you go to any product that is agriculture in nature. The better monies are at the top of the food chain. They are not at the farming level. And we need to see how we can plug into those gaps, then assist our farmers. Now, this is really a pitch to, because certainly many of you are located in the central region where even U.M.A is. And there are unique opportunities here that, one, we have large tracts of land, especially outside the city center. Some of you come from well-heeled families that have square miles of land. And the opportunity is to say that, yes, even if you're not setting up an industry yourself, perhaps you're setting up an industry support facility in terms of a private industrial park. There are quite a raft of incentives for private industrial parks that you could take advantage of. And no, an industrial park does not have to be on a square mile. It could be something as simple as a warehousing shed that accommodates different small enterprises. Because one of our biggest arguments as U.M.A has been to say that even as we set up the numbers of this world for the big players, we need SME parks where I need maybe a 10 by 10 room to just put up one piece of machinery that does a specific item, where we can agglomerate a number of different players within the same shed, and one feeds into the other. And therefore, you have an industry developing, not because there is a big player, but rather because there are many small players. For those of you who have read the story of South Korea or the story of Shanghai and a number of other places, this is how they started. They started with the knowledge that, look, if you go to Masaka, they are the razor blade makers of this country. If you go to Jinja, they are the safety pin makers. And because of that, they've then been able to accelerate growth because slowly they've grown into bigger things. Now, the second bit is given that the biggest percentage of Uganda's economic activity happens in the central region, it also creates a key market, a key place to put produce and products that you produce, especially if you're focusing on the local market. Logistics is also critical because as a manufacturer seeking to either head out into the country or head out of the country, you have to be able to access quick and efficient logistics. Today, when you order a shoe in New York, you're able to customize it. But that shoe is not made in somewhere in Brooklyn. It's actually made so many kilometers away in Sri Lanka, but they guarantee you a 5-day turnaround time. That within 5 days, you've made the order, it has been customized, and it has been sent to you, and it's on your doorstep. To do that, to have that level of efficiency, you need to be in a location that can get you into the market quite quickly. That then explains the international airport for both cargo and passenger transit transport, access to support services and skill sets, the banks and all these other initiatives, ease of interconnection, name it. And to understand why it's important to speak about import substitution and the elements that we could focus on, these are just random figures picked from the statistics on importation for Uganda. And as you can see, we are exporting quite a bit of jobs if we're talking about multiplier effect of manufacturing. Because in 2019, we imported $18.9 million of raw plastic sheeting from the Republic of Kenya, mostly. That's 78%. We imported plastic lids. These are covers for your buckets and a lot of other things. Also from India and Kenya, worth $23 million in total, but the majority of it coming from India and Kenya. As you can see, the list is dominated by either India, China, Kenya, Egypt. There's also a bit of Poland. And I'll draw your attention to Poland in particular because used clothing imported $38.8 million worth of used clothing out of the country. And the majority of this came from a bit of this came from India, a bit of it came from Poland, some of it came from the US, of course. And herein is the opportunity that if you've had a chance to follow the cotton value chain, the additional value that comes to bear because of the production of a shirt is value that would change quite a lot of lives. But relatedly, the ability to make a shirt is not rocket science. Today, I keep telling the reporters who come to ask about why we insist on replacing used clothing, on banning the importation of used clothing, among other things. I keep telling them that if you walk around during school times, if you walk around any Kampala street or upcountry roads at about 5 p.m. in the evening, you're going to see a myriad of colors, of uniforms, of people walking along the street, children going back home from their schools, for those who are in their school. And my question has always been, don't we think those students are smart? The answer is usually yes. They look quite smart. It's quite nice seeing them. And I said, but all those are made in Uganda products. The materials, some are imported, yes, but many are Ugandan materials made from Ugandan cotton, which means we have the capacity to make some of these products, the clothes, the chitenges and all those. We make them here. So don't tell me that we cannot make shirts, that we cannot make coats. One of the best makers of suits I know is based in Chiembe somewhere. And you can't tell that it's a Ugandan made product because they emphasize quality. And mark you, the training for a team to make a shirt takes 2 weeks, irrespective of level of education. So it's not even about education or skilling. But we need to be intentional about supporting import substitution. So these are some of the areas where we are sending out money. And it's sad that we are exporting this kind of money. That's the case, and those are the opportunities that we can tap into. Now, what are the incentives? Earlier, I indicated that I would delve into some of the incentives. I'll be very high level about this because this information is available on both the URA and UIA websites, so you can access it. But I've already told you that raw materials used in the production of goods meant for export, have the duty drawback feature, in that even if you've paid for some of the raw materials, you're able to claim back the taxes on some of these materials. Plant, machinery and equipment used in production of goods for export, that's already at zero. Manufacture of tires, there's a duty remission of zero, meaning that the materials used in the production of this can come in at zero duty. Paper for the manufacture of excise books and textbooks, these are imported at zero, and so on and so forth. This booklet that has this information is about 40 pages long. And within that, you can see the opportunities for where you can target. On the agro-processing side, there's a lot of duties that have been placed on importation of agriculture products, because certainly we have a need for them here. Scrap batteries for the manufacture of lead batteries is also remitted to zero. Gas cylinders is also remitted to zero, and so on and so forth. Like I said, there's quite a long list of incentives available. And if you take the chance to read through them, you'll be shocked at the number of things that can be done in this country. The other opportunity, of course, is that as a country, we are still designated an LDC. And the opportunity in that is that our products then access the European market, but also the American market at duty-free, which means that while the product coming in from a more developed country would incur a penalty in terms of tax as it's entering, let's say, the UK or the American market, yours from Uganda enters at zero duty, which means that if you've actually done your product well and certified the requirement, you can benefit from some of these more developed markets where the need for these products is quite high. So what are the lessons for startup? I think the lessons, one, is we tend to overthink it. We tend to think that you need $1 million before you can even think about manufacturing. And ours is to debunk that and say, you start where you are with what you have. Manufacturing is not that big piece of machinery. Manufacturing is value addition. One element of value addition that I keep pointing out is the most basic level of value addition is the making of potato crisps that you buy in your supermarkets at a very high price. Today, I think the last I checked, a bag of a 250-gram bag of potato crisps was, if I'm not mistaken, retailing at about, is it 1,000 shillings or something? But how many Irish potatoes go into a bag of potato crisps? I don't know. Is it half? Is it a full potato crisp? And perhaps Enterprise Uganda can help us with that research. And why I'm pointing this out is that even that is an element of value addition. But you are getting a step onto the ladder of manufacturing that can then grow you. All you need is a knife and a kalai, or a frying pan for that matter, to fry these items. So is it still very expensive to get into manufacturing? I don't think so. If you look at the big manufacturers today, the roofings, let's say, of this world, steel and tube industries, these started as small shops. Roofing started as a small shop selling nails. Today, it's a 25-year-old multinational industry. Steel and tube industries, who of us doesn't remember hardware deals, the hardware dealer? Today, they're manufacturing steel. Nice House of Plastics started as a very small company. And today, they've expanded into a number of products. So I think the challenge we have is we tend to think of the big brands, and we tend to want to start big. We want to import the best machinery from Germany to start our factory. That's not the case. That's small. Today, a packing machine, a machine that packs, that makes tea bags, costs about, if I'm not mistaken, the cheapest I've seen is about $2,000, which is roughly 7 million, landed Kampala from China. The opportunity there is you can go buy tea, mix it yourself, and pack it and sell it on the market. It doesn't need rocket science to do that. Gonja crisps. I'm addicted to Gonja crisps myself. And it's an easy opportunity there. Get to know what it takes, buy the Gonja, slice it, fry it, put it up for sale. So start where you are with what you have, is what I'm trying to say. Number two, look for a need. The challenge we have, we have a very bad copycat syndrome. To say that, Daniel is doing ABCD. It looks like he's doing well. Let me also go into that. Without necessarily knowing whether there's a need for that product or whether the product is saturated. Understand the market you're getting into. Understand the need that you're fulfilling before you then invest into that area. Number three is affiliate yourself with membership associations. These are the Small Scale Industries Association, Manufacturer Association, Private Sector Foundation, etc., etc. The opportunity there is these entities are able to sit down with you and guide you on the opportunities that are available, on the incentives that are available. I'll tell you that today, there are companies that have benefited from funding for machinery, grant funding for machinery, because all they had was an idea and were connected to the right people to then provide them the finances to buy this machinery. So it's about linking yourself to the people who know about this. Enterprise Uganda has a lot of information on this. Reach out to them, talk to them, tell them what you're thinking so that you can appreciate the opportunities available for you within that sector. The other one is acquaint yourself with local and global moves to get accustomed to the idea of reading the wind. And here the example is this, that today a foam sector manufacturer, someone who manufactures mattresses, has to keep an eye on the price of oil globally. Why? Because some of the inputs into manufacturing foam are inputs that arise out of refining oil. So if the price of oil goes up, you have to hedge, because you know that that price is going to hit you eventually. So you have to make your order early and get your raw materials early in. So this is training. You have to learn to understand the market that you're getting into. You have to understand the drivers for that market and to be able to hedge against any disruptions. The last one there is taking advantage of training and readiness programs. Enterprise Uganda has done a very good job of this. They are able to talk you through what to think about when starting up. How do you deal with governance? How do you deal with networking? Who do you need to talk to get your licensing in place? Stanbic Bank has an incubation program that runs cohorts pretty often. And a number of other entities are also doing this. Get to know what they're doing, get in touch with them so that you can appreciate them. The other one is that you have a sandbox element. For those of you who are in computing, the sandbox is where you get to play with your software before you put it out in the real world. And the Uganda Industry Research Institute has just that. And they have machinery, they have the experts. Go approach them and see if you can set up and do a dry run of your idea before you actually go to import machinery. Who knows, you may find that perhaps instead of this particular piece of machinery, you need another. And a number of brands that we celebrate today have actually been groomed and grown in the Industrial Research Institute. They have an innovation center. Makerere University also has an industrial research center where you can try out a number of products. Go, try them out, and then get into the real world. Of course, the other big one is analysis paralysis, where we think and overthink decisions and want to think about them over and over again. Let's make the perfect market research. Let's make the perfect staffing profile. Let's recruit the right people. Let's get the right machinery in. by the time you actually get to start, the people who went to URI and started out by testing have gone well ahead of you because they have a critical piece that you don't have. They've been in the market and they understand the market and their product is able to make mileage. So stop overthinking things. If you think an idea works, there are less risky ways to trial it. Trial it and see what happens and then get out into the world. Now, this is a slide I usually use to stimulate debate, to say that even as we think of the bigger things, sometimes the smaller things in front of us, we are missing. The export market for citrus and melon peels internationally in 2019 stood at $115 million. I'll let that sink in. These are citrus is oranges, orange peels. Yes, orange peels and watermelon peels. The international market for that in 2019 was $115 million. Those are the countries that imported it. And on the right are the countries that exported it. Now, sorry, our exporters are on the left, our importers are on the right. Now, you will notice that within there, the only African countries that have significant mileage are Ghana and Senegal. But that's not to say they are the biggest producers of watermelon or citrus. Uganda is up there, but we're not in the list of exporters of these peels. If you go to the average market, they're probably rotting on the floor. Can we tease out such opportunities so that we can show, so that we can get into areas where no one else is thinking about? I could do a similar slide for pumpkin seeds. I could do a similar slide for quite a number of other products that we have in plenty here, but we let go to waste, and yet there's a significant market for them. That really is the end of my talk on manufacturing opportunities. I hope it has stimulated some thought in you. We're always available at the Manufacturing Association to talk to you, to appreciate your specific needs and aid you on your journey. I said in the beginning that you need to take a mental snapshot of the image I shared, which was an image of the Namamve Industrial Park. This, on the other hand, is an image of Hawassa Industrial Park in Addis Ababa. And if I put them side by side, you as an entrepreneur, which one would you choose to invest in? I don't point this out to show the challenge. I point this out to show the opportunity that we are in dire need of plug and play industrial parks as a country. Places where people can go and just put machinery and start working. And like I said in the beginning, do not dream of a square mile of investment. You don't need it. Even a small warehouse with spaces for manufacturers, having access to grid electricity and water, and having access to good roads is a good enough investment that can help you start your off in supporting manufacturing or going into manufacturing. Thank you so much, and thank you for listening. Over to you, Ronald.
Oh, wow. Thanks a lot, Daniel, for that provocative presentation. I hope you have all enjoyed it as much as I have. There were a number of questions. I think, Daniel, the first question you'll answer is, what do watermelon peels and citrus peels actually do? I think someone already asked it in the chat box. It was the first question in my mind. I didn't even know they were being exported in the first place, let alone $115 million on an annual basis. So it's been such a stimulating presentation. And I want to just thank you so much for sharing your heart, for inspiring us, and for challenging us to look at this sector with possibly a new eye. At this point, Daniel, I think we'll get into a couple of questions. There are already a number streaming in. I'm going to encourage all of us to participate. If you want to drop a question, please drop it in the chat box. In the next session, I also give an opportunity to a couple of people who want to put up their hands to say something, to ask, you could as well ask a couple of questions. Daniel, there are a couple of questions here. I'm going to put them to you. I'll put to you 3 to 4 questions, and then we will possibly have another round of questions. The first one was that question I asked, what do peels do? There is a question from Chuck's Foot. I wanted you to throw a bit more light on the incentives of manufacturing as they seem to be on paper. He has mentioned he has started a novel manufacturing plant, which even UNBS didn't have any definitive standards for. He's looking for how can he get support for clearance, and possibly you can tell him that from the perspective of UMA also. Bruce also asked, do you need to be registered with UMA to access import tax incentives, or do you apply directly to URA? That's another question. There was a question also from Maureen about, you talked about the free duty book, the book which you said is a number of pages. The question is it available online and where can it be accessed? Daniel, we could just touch on those 4 questions and then I'll give you another round of questions after.
Thank you, Ronald. One on the watermelon peels and citrus peels. Those of you who've used the cologne or perfumes, you know that there are bases that are used in making these perfumes, the essences. So some of these products, for example, the citrus side, are the essences that are used as ingredients in perfumery. So there is an extra, they extract this essence and use it in making the perfumes. For the watermelon peels, some of them are considered quite medicinal, and there's quite a bit of research that has gone into utilizing watermelon peels and making herbal supplements as key uses for humans. So that's the opportunity therein. That's the use. But I think what the question I expected instead was, how do we export them? Because we don't lack them. The question is, how do we export them? I think the process of exporting is dependent on the country. Germany, for example, will tell you you need a number of licenses to indicate that this is organically sourced and does not have chemicals, is not going to cause human life loss. So it's about understanding this. And frankly, if you walk into any, if you understand where they go, because I shared that, but even if you went online and checked, you would easily understand which countries are concerned with this, and their embassies are always willing to link you up with would-be importers on their end, because they are very interested. They don't have enough supplies. So walk into an embassy, talk to an embassy, they'll be able to guide you on how to go through the export process. Incentives for manufacturing. And relatedly, the booklets that have this information. One is the Uganda Investment Authority website has significant information on the investment incentives in Uganda. But the Uganda Revenue Authority website also has a listing of the tax related measures that apply to manufacturing and a lot of other sectors, as well as industrial parks. These two can be useful. The investment facilitation officers at UIA would be very happy to help. But if you're not able to get that information from them, get in touch with us. I'll leave my email address at the end and we'll be able to send it to you or send you the link if you would like. As far as access to the incentives, especially the industrial park incentives and all, does not require you to know anyone or anything. It's the parameters are set out in the law to say that if you invest a certain amount of money, automatically you qualify for these incentives. So you need only write to the Minister of Finance and say you're investing in this. The joy, the beauty of associations such as ours is that rather than you flapping in the wind and going from office to office, we do the work of approaching of linking you to the right people to get this done. So link up with any association that is worth its salt. It will be able to assist you to access some of these incentives. Some of them are ring-fenced for recommendations from entities such as the Uganda Manufacturers Association. One of them is PVOC, pre-export verification of conformity under UNBS, that we are able to assist to write to UNBS and say, these products, this is the manufacturer who is a member of U.M.A, we can vouch for them. Let them present their products, come in and avoid pre-export verification. The other ones are access to raw materials under URA. We have a relationship with URA such that if we recommend that you get exemption on raw materials, if they qualify, that will be done. Also on machinery, it's important that you belong to an association that can vouch for you and is then able to tell URA that this machinery is coming in for a manufacturer, and as such, they need to benefit from the wave of import duties. This is how it's done. I think the last one was on importation of items and import tax, and whether people qualify. I think I've explained that. I say comment. Someone was indicating that the law is applied separately by individual. I would beg to differ. I believe that we've gotten so used to having to pay extra to access support that we think it's the norm everywhere. And I think many of you will attest to the fact that things have changed in a couple of areas. And as an association, we are always willing to hand walk you to these areas. If you feel that perhaps you're hitting a snag, come to us. We'll be happy to help and get some of these initiatives out of the way. Over to you, Ronald.
Thanks a lot, Daniel. I'll give an opportunity to anyone who wants to ask a question. Daniel, as we await anyone who wants to possibly, please just do put up your hand and then I'll give you an opportunity. There's a question here from Julian about the especially the policy around imports, and it appears that even things which we can make here are still being imported, yogurt, matchboxes. She talks about the garlic from China. So she wanted you to touch on that and see, is there a thrust to make sure that this doesn't happen, and possibly what are the challenges in that area that we need to kind of pay attention to? That was from Julian. Christine asked about the virgin areas in manufacturing, the places where you think what you'd call the low-hanging fruits. If you could touch on those, that would be nice, Daniel. And then definitely there was the question of perception about the local products. What's your take? Because there's a feel that possibly most Ugandans, and that was from Chuck's Foods, most Ugandans are not as excited about our local products as they are. As someone who is on the front line, what is your comment about that? Before you come in, Daniel, I'm going to give an opportunity to Maureen, and then to Samuel, and then Daniel will respond. Maureen, over to you. Maureen, you can speak, please. Maureen, you seem to be breaking up.
Hello, you can hear me?
Okay.
Hello, Maureen, perhaps you type your message.
I think I feel like you're breaking up, unfortunately. Samuel, let's try Samuel and then see how that goes. Samuel, over to you. Please do speak.
Thank you very much, Ronald. I want to thank our brother Daniel for giving us this awesome presentation. My name is Samuel Bakutana. I'm a certified executive coach. I'm a leadership consultant, a speaker and author, and I lead an organization called Inspired Leaders International as the CEO. So I am in the people development industry. and I play at a global level. One thing I have found out through my personal experience empowering the different manufacturing teams is that we tend to put a lot of focus on the technical competence of the staff, the technical competence of the managers, of the senior management teams, and so on and so forth. But we do not give any attention to leadership leadership development. The only time that happens is when there is a once in a while small training, sometimes as just a small insert into a longer technical jargon meeting. So yet I realize that these manufacturing companies, whether it is in agriculture, whether it is in all these kinds of companies that do manufacture, the biggest challenge is not that they lack the raw materials, it's not that they lack, you know, the financial capital or the infrastructure capital, but they are over-managed and under-led. They are poorly led. I just did a training for a manufacturing company I will not mention just about 2 months ago. And the biggest issue was that the leaders were messing up the whole industry. They were messing up the whole industry because all that they are focusing on is how to get more money, how to squeeze the workers, and so on and so forth. So as a result, you find that internally, there is catastrophe. And at the end of the day, even when they produce a lot of wonderful products, the staff are not willing to push it forward into the market, let alone talk about export. So my question to Daniel is, what are you doing as the Uganda Manufacturers Association to ensure that the manufacturing companies are well led so that there is visionary, long-term, and people-sensitive manufacturing sector in the country? Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Samuel, for that submission. And over-manage, under-led. Julian, you had your hand up. Julian, are you there? It's Julian. I seem to have lost Julian. He had his hand up, possibly. Maureen, you still have your hand up. Did you type your question or...
Yes, I can try now.
Yes, Maureen, I think we hear you better now.
I'm seeing three current challenges. One is the unreliable electricity resulting in very many losses. And then secondly is the noise pollution, which is also affecting the labor force because the team never gets to rest because of the neighbors. And thirdly is the young population, which we are eager and willing to put in place. But they're very eager to also get quick, very rich, and that's resulting in losses from the establishment. How can these three issues be solved? How can UMA help us in these three areas? Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Maureen. Daniel, I think you can get a go at that, and hopefully we could have one more round.
All right, thank you very much. I'll start with Maureen. Maureen, as an association, we have a raft of services, member support services that we involve ourselves in. On the issue of electricity reliability, we are constantly, at least on at the very worst, on a quarterly basis, in engagement with the Electricity Regulator Authority to resolve member challenges as far as access to reliable electricity is concerned, because given that we are trying to drive increased consumption of electricity, any unreliability has a significant impact on that. But just on that particular issue, the reliable electricity, at times it's a case of requiring an additional investment, which then has to be mainstreamed into the budget for the concessionaire for the next period. At times it's a case of setting up in a residential area when you're using industrial grade power. It could be anything. I can't give a diagnostic based on just that information. If you could come in, we would be very happy to have a chat with you on that. The issue of noise pollution, we have a relationship with NEMA, who can come in to assist, or KCCA for that matter, but you could also reach out to these entities yourself and seek assistance resolve that. Internal theft, I think it's a factor of training, it's a factor of the recruitment policies in place and how you onboard your people. These can, I don't think these are insurmountable problems. They're problems that have been faced by many manufacturers and they can be resolved. The other question was on the training and the lack of training for leadership, leadership training within the manufacturing entities. And I would say that, yes, it's a key concern within the manufacturing sector, but not only within the manufacturing sector, within business in general. The level of training we have in our technical and universities focuses largely on technical skills and does not focus on the soft skills. That's why as a manufacturer association, we are running a number of projects that are focused on reskilling graduates from these entities, placing them into our manufacturing establishments for at least 3 months, and then taking them back with a new attitude. We found that because of this, about 60% of those who go through that program get retained within their respective companies they go to, but they also have accelerated growth wherever they go. So yes, we are doing something about it, but relatedly, we also have a training center as the UMA, and we are constantly engaging with these manufacturing entities to guide them and to provide training for them on leadership, on human resource practices. Over the past 2 weeks, we've been undertaking two successive trainings, one on responsible business practices, the other on gender in the workplace, and how to make sure that as an HR manager, as a CEO, you're making sure that your location is not only gender sensitive, but also gender violence responsive, that you're able to identify, isolate, and solve these issues right on time. So we're not sitting back. We're actually heavily engaged, and we welcome you to come and speak to us about your offerings. Perhaps there's a potential for partnership there to see how we can move that forward. The other one was around local products and the excitement around the lack of excitement around local products. And mine is to say this, that I don't know how many of you have, during the course of your lifetimes in Uganda, taken imported sugar. I don't think there are very many. Why? Because we've supported, we've bought Ugandan sugar. For all the years I've been alive, I've been using Ugandan sugar. Soap is also pretty much made here. The plastic items we use, many of them are made here. And for me, it's a case of us defining what standards we would like as a country. The beauty here is that the Uganda National Bureau of Standards always asks the public for comments when it's developing new standards. And these standards are what then guide the production process because they are enforced by UNBS. We need to pay attention to these standards as citizenry. We need to be engaged in those discussions because these are public hearings. We need to be engaged in the discussions on standards so that we can set standards as a country that speak for our requirements as consumers. Having said that, for any item that is standardized and is on the shelf, I can guarantee you that its quality has been tested and vetted and that it's on the shelf because it meets certain quality parameters. That being the case, I think it's time that we also thought as Ugandans about supporting Ugandan companies. Purpose that each time you go to the supermarket, you push the envelope in as far as the percentage of Ugandan products in your cart as compared to the percentage of foreign products. Because when you buy Ugandan, you are hiring your brother, your sister, your mother, your relative. You're getting them a job. But it's only through you purchasing these products that they'll be able to improve continually based on your feedback, but also based on the fact that you're supporting them. Many of you will remember the Nomi that started out. The Nomi is a washing powder from Mokwano that started out a while back. Did it have a few challenges? Yes. But because of feedback, that product has now moved and it's the market leader. We don't need to import any washing powder anymore as a country because, well, we can produce it locally. The beauty of that is that we've saved quite a bit as a country. We've hired quite a bit of people. Cooking oil, same story. Capacity to grow is organic and it keeps growing. But it only happens when we purpose to support our industries. If we choose to say that we are going to keep importing products from elsewhere, believe you me, eventually the companies here will collapse and we will get what we want. We'll get products from elsewhere, but we'll never ever develop as a country. So it's upon us to do that. The other question was around import substitution, the challenges of enforcement of import substitution. I think it's early stages yet. There's quite a bit of movement on this. As you've noticed, there's a new raft of tax measures that have been introduced on imports. And these tax measures have the purpose of convincing you, the entrepreneurs, to invest in some of these areas. Now, if we don't invest, of course, eventually it's going to be that since capacity has failed to be generated locally, let's open up again so that these items can come from outside Uganda. And we don't want that. What we need you to do is tell us what more you need in order to assist you to enter some of these markets. But relatedly, focus on the lists of imports that we have as a country and mention what you would like as support. If you're an entrepreneur, what would you like as support to go into some of these areas? Because the government right now is looking for ways to activate import substitution. And if you have the solution, believe you me, there will be quite a bit of support. Relatedly, there are a number of funds that are available, private equity, venture capital, and even angel investment available for investors going into, for example, agro-industrialization or agro-processing. Reach out to them. One of them is Power Capital Partners, which is running the Yield Fund that invests in agro-processing. Reach out to them and talk to them. They're always willing to talk and see what your business is like and whether they can support. And a couple of others that would benefit from, that you could benefit from. Take advantage of this so that you can take advantage of the import substitution opportunities.
Thanks a lot, Daniel. I think we have a couple of people as we run to the end of our session today. I was very interested in that question of Ugandans being excited about buying Ugandan, build Uganda, buy Uganda. I remember a while back, the only music we used to listen to was Congolese music. And I think nowadays you would struggle to turn on a radio station and you don't find local music, which is possibly even Uganda, most likely Ugandan music. I think it's possible to change any sector and transform it. It takes work, as Daniel has mentioned, but I'm optimistic that we actually have the capacity to do just that. I will pick a couple of questions from Box Shop, South Africa, and then Julian. Box Shop, you can go first, and then we'll read the questions in the comment, and then we will wrap up the day. Box Shop, South Africa. The Box Shop, South Africa, are you there? All right, let's try it, Julian.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yes, thanks for the team that organized this. I had to step away abruptly, but I think I came back when Daniel was addressing my question. I listened to what he said. And I appreciate it, although I don't think the government has done enough of what it should do in terms of import substitution. Again, I allude to the fact that you have products in the market like garlic, which I imported from China, and yet we have farmers here who can grow those products up clear. So, and talking about the government making efforts on import levies and that sort of thing, the thing is that if the government expects to add the levy and then it thinks that the farmers or the entrepreneurs are going to organize themselves in 1 month and have that product on the stalls and in the shops. That's not possible. So I think they need to undertake a process where they advise the country as a whole through U.M.A. and the trade bodies, and say that these products are going to either be banned as imports in the next 1 year or in the next 6 months, so that the local people who have the capability to manufacture or to grow or to process also have plans which they can implement over time. Because I'll tell you, there are a number of products which Kenya has banned from Uganda. At some point, it was sugar. At some point, it was milk. Milk has now sort of gone back a bit. But still, you see, the people who make the policies in the Ministry of Trade and all that, they are not switched on enough to tell that we are spending so much on exports. It's affecting a balance of trade. So I would appreciate if U.M.A. and Enterprise Uganda can do a bit more to guide the government and the policymakers on how we can all be supported. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Julian, for that submission. Indeed, there is quite a bit more work to do in that space. And I think that feedback is very well received by Daniel and myself. And we'll see how to get there. Daniel, there, I wanted to just get one or two more questions, and then I can hand over to you. The box shop, are you there? All right, the box shop is not coming through. He has his hand up, but it's not coming through. Daniel, there was also a question on the low-hanging fruits, some of the low-hanging fruits in manufacturing. If there are a couple of sectors which you think, and I think you have broadly kind of tested it, but you can allude to that one more time. Great. Chuck's Foods, a bit more time for the session. I think we'll consider that feedback, sir, as we plan. To make sure that we can keep these conversations going. Daniel, I'll hand back to you to bring this home, and then we can be able to wrap up the day.
Thank you, Ronald. A submission, I couldn't agree more. And like I said, there was a slide that was dedicated to challenges. If you started me on challenges of manufacturing, we would have another 2 hours to speak about the challenges and what we think should be done to address that. But today's session is meant to inspire you all to look at manufacturing with a new eye, through a new lens, as a potential area for you to go into. To your point, yes, I totally agree that an annual tax and policy cycle is ludicrous for long-term planning, because as a baseline, our businesses usually operate on strategic plans that are 2 to 5 years in length. So essentially, in communicating that you have an annual tax policy cycle, you're communicating that our businesses should operate on a strategic plan of 1 year, and which is subject to change every 27th of June, because 1st July, new measures come into force. And I think more voices need to join the chorus to say, we need to think about maybe a longer term perspective. To say, look, as government, we are signaling that for the next 2-3 years, these are our focus areas. These are the policies that are coming in place, and therefore going forward, plan for this. It helps with planning. It helps with stability. And it means that we don't spend half the first quarter firefighting against new policies that have come in that are not based in reality. But I'm optimistic that this is a work in progress. We are constantly engaged with our partners in the ministries, departments, and agencies to see that this comes to fruition. And we remain optimistic that it will happen, because one thing for anyone going into manufacturing, one thing they need to know is manufacturing is not is not a short-term game. You don't get into manufacturing looking for returns in 1 year, 2 years. This is 5 years to 15 years. This is the kind of business we are in. And so everyone has to come into that with their eyes open. And policy advocacy is a similar situation. Christian's question, I did see the question, Christian, but I preambled this presentation by saying I wasn't going to do any crystal ball gazing. To say, go and put money in this kanokafuna, kanotikafuna, like the people in the central region say. It's not that kind of presentation. Mine is to say, one, analyze the need. If there is a need, there is an opportunity, and you can fit into that opportunity. I gave you some examples of some needs that I've perceived and that we've perceived at the UMA as opportunities that we could take advantage of. A big one was the issue of agro-processing and value addition into agricultural produce. Because as a country, we produce a lot more, but we export most of it in raw form. What can we do about that? As a country, the average, I don't know, probably about 40% of fruits are lost due to poor handling, due to rotting, due to all kinds of things. What about a solution around solving the longevity of some of these products? Because if you go to Europe, for example, they're taking on dried fruit. They're using it in their cereal. They're using it in all sorts of additives. Have we thought about how we can plug into that market so that we don't leave it for the likes of Thailand? I could go on and on. There are so many areas, but it's about what is the need? How can you plug into that? The other bit I said was that use the sandboxes that are available in terms of the Uganda Industrial Research Institute, Makerere University Research Center, to try out your product so that you don't get burnt if you're not sure about the viability of it, because then you get out of it knowing exactly what you need to do to make it work. I just wanted to finish with one last piece, really, on Ugandan products. I think we've come, like Ronald said, we've come quite a long way in as far as product development. And product development is a constant effort by our members. It's a constant effort based on feedback, which is why when you send a message and say, look, I bought this batch of yogurt from Daniel's company, but it turns out it was not right. The companies quickly respond to you and want you to tell them more so they can calibrate their machines better, probably. It's developing Uganda's manufacturing sector cannot be left to the producers alone. The consumers also have a role to play. When you buy that product and it's bad, and you choose to just throw it away and say, you know what, I'll never buy Daniel's product again, you're not helping. You need to bring up the issue so that it can be taken up and it can be followed up. As an association, it's one of the things we're trying to do now, to also focus on consumer engagement and understanding the consumer pains so that we can feedback better to our members and say, look, there are challenges here, here, and here. You need to solve those up as quickly as possible. But we need to work together. And like I said, when you go to a supermarket, please, our request as manufacturers, make sure that the percentage of Ugandan products in your basket is beyond the percentage of foreign products, and that you continually keep trying us out. Try out our products. You'll be pleasantly surprised. Some are even, many actually, are better than the imported version, but because there's that preconception about Ugandan products, you miss out on some significant opportunities. Having said that, I wish to say thank you so much for listening to me, for sparing your time. My email address, I saw a request for it, is ed@uma.or.ug. And we try to respond to as many emails as fast as possible. If we delay, please send a reminder. Copy to administration@uma.or.ug. Our teams will be happy to reach out and see how they can assist you. I wish you a very good day and a good rest of the week. Over to you, Julian. Sorry, over to you, Ronald.
Thanks a lot, Daniel. We have had a pleasant 1.5 hours as we have discussed this subject, which we honestly can't exhaust. But I'm very excited that there are a couple of ideas which have come out. I hope you have been challenged to look at this sector. I think every time you say the word invest in Uganda, it seems as though you are talking about real estate. And I think for me, that's one of the things which was exciting about this conversation, to see the many opportunities that exist in manufacturing at different levels. And I hope that this challenges us to actually pay a bit of attention to this as a sector, but more specifically, the opportunities that have come up. Once again, I want to say a big thank you to Daniel Birungi, who is the Executive Director at Uganda Manufacturers Association, for honoring us with his presence and his time during this conversation. Please do reach out to him. Daniel, I'm going to request that you post your email address in the chat box also, and also the admin email address, so that some people specifically can be able to reach out. There were some specific requests for that. I want to thank each and every one of you for taking time and being here for this call. Every Thursday at 9 o'clock, we come together for what we have called the recovery series. The recovery series are focused largely on us coming together to build our businesses, to restart our businesses, to grow our businesses. At Enterprise Uganda, we believe in the Ugandan entrepreneur. We believe in the Ugandan small and medium enterprise. We believe that we are the ones who are going to contribute to the transformation of this nation. And we are totally committed to doing everything possible to ensure that this keeps happening. We are going to keep these conversations going. We will invite people from the various sectors and various areas of expertise. Next Thursday, we'll be sharing with you who we'll be having. But largely what we'd want to say is a big thank you for this opportunity. And we are hopeful that together we can be able to not only transform our businesses, but transform our country so that we achieve those goals which we aspire for. Thanks a lot once again. Once again, towards the end, I'll request that we have run over 10:30 by a couple of minutes. But as we close, I will request that you post your name and tell us your name and what you do. Just post that into our chat box. If you have seen someone who you are interested in, just drop them a line, tell them you want to do business with them. That's the purpose of this engagement. So thanks a lot and have a lovely rest of the day as we push and grow our businesses.